Today is about Sutomo Ganbe Rinzai. There will be three people running these sessions. One is Estrella, that is already there. It will give a brief introduction about theory. And then two of our, I would say, the best users we have, they are beta testers. They have helped a lot in stabilizing what you are practicing this week. They have suffered a lot, and this is us to blame, because when you are trying to develop something, there's a huge instability in the code, and they have gone through all this helping to stabilize. So great part of the stabilization that, and believe me, this is quite stable compared to what we had 6 months ago. So great of the stabilization you are experiencing about the software is due to the tests they are carrying out. So I would like to thank them for the effort. And without any ado, I think I give the presentation role to Estrella, and we can kick off this session.
Okay. Thank you, Pablo. Well, first of all, can you see my pointer? Yes, I think. Okay, so good morning, everyone. Welcome to the third day of this tomography virtual course. Today we are going to talk about subtomogram aberration. I'm Estrella Fernandez, as Pablo said. I'm a PhD student of the lab. But today also we have with us Ana Cuervo and Patricia Lozana that are an expert users on tomography in SIPM. So we are going to begin with a brief theoretical introduction, and we will see what are we going to do today. And then you will see the workflow with Patricia and Ana. So, to do subtomogram aberration, we basically need just the subtomograms that you have extracted after the picking and so on. However, to do a proper refinement of that subtomogram aberration, it's important to take into account the whole workflow of the tomography path. So the thing is that we are going to begin with the tomogram. We are not going to see again the part from the TIL series to the tomogram because we don't have time. But I have to say that there is a way or a kind of refinement that also uses information in the TIL series. So this is just to illustrate you that to do the subtomogram aberration, we need the particles, the subtomograms, but it's very important to take into account the whole workflow that we have performed. So today we are going to start just from the tomogram, sorry, and then we are going to do the picking. I know that you yesterday saw a lot of strategies of picking, but today what we are going to do is to apply the picking strategy that is better for our data. Then once we have extracted our subtomograms, basically, we are going to perform some classification. I know also that you yesterday saw some kind of classification using PySeq, and today we are going to see another ways to perform this classification. We want to do some classification in order to basically remove the particles that are, for example, bad picked, or that they do not look good enough, so they are going to blur our model instead of improve it. So that's why we want to do that classification. And at the end, we are going to do the refining, that is the proper subtomogram averaging step that basically or usually have two different steps. One is to create an initial model and then to refine that initial model to get a better resolution. So I'm sure that you know this perfectly, but just to remember, The subtomogram averaging step, we can say that is equivalent to the step in single particle of doing the volume reconstruction. However, there is a crucial difference between these two processes, because in subtomogram averaging, we already have volumes. We have three-dimensional volumes. I mean, we have a tomogram that is already a volume. It has its three dimensions. Then we extract little volumes from them that are the subtomogram that are already three-dimensional volumes. What we do with these three-dimensional volumes is we perform an alignment, but it's not the same kind of alignment that we perform in single particle, because here we are just putting all the subtomograms in the same position. We don't have to align them with respect to a volume or whatever. We just have to put them in the same position. So once we have all our subtomograms in the same position, we can do an average of all these volumes. And what we get is another volume which has contributions of all the small volumes. Then we can refine it and we can do more things. But basically the process is this one. However, in single particle, what we have is bidimensional particles. We have bidimensional images that are projection of a volume that we reconstruct from all of these different bidimensional views. So in single particle, we are dealing with from bidimensional images create a three-dimensional volume, while in subtomogram averaging, we already have volumes and we align and average them to have a better volume. That's important because all the processes for subtomogram averaging will usually be more time-consuming and resources-consuming than the ones for single particles, because we are already working with three-dimensional volumes. However, some steps of our subtomogram averaging workflow we can perform in 2D, in two dimension, just in two dimension, just to save time, mainly. So what we can do is, with our subtomograms, for example, in classification, we can take our three-dimensional subtomograms and we can convert them to bidimensional images. I know that you yesterday saw something related to this. You see some two-dimensional classification in PiSec, but what we were doing yesterday is to compute the radial average of this volume, and in that way, that radial average will be a bidimensional image, and you classify that. Today, what we are going to do is to take the three-dimensional volumes, and we are going to compute the projections of these volumes. In this way, we also have a bidimensional image that we can classify. The thing in to the classification is just that, to take the volumes, the three-dimensional volumes, and in some way convert them into the images with sufficient information to perform a classification. Why we want to do that? Because to perform a classification in 2D instead of 3D, it's much more cheaper in terms of time and resources. The thing is, another option other reason to do a two-dimensional classification is, once we have compute these projections, we have particles that are equivalent to the particles that we have in single particle. And that means that we can use all the methods that we know to do two-dimensional classification in single particle analysis, we can apply to classify our projected subtomograms. Another way to convert volumes or subtomograms to the images could be just taking the central slice, for example. The thing is that once we have classified in 2D, once we have removed the bad particles, the particles that we don't want to do for doing the subtomogram averaging, the thing is, okay, we have now good particles, but they are bidimensional. They are images, projection, radial averages, or whatever, but they are bidimensional. And to do the refinement or the subtomogram averaging, what we need are the volumes. So you will see that in Scipion we have a way to go back from the projections to the particles, the subtomograms, where we from which we have created the projections and recover the subtomograms that are good enough to do the subtomogram averaging process. Of course, we can also do a three-dimensional classification. We are going to perform also a three-dimensional classification, as you will see. And the thing is that with a three-dimensional classification, we can do a much more accurate classification because we have the whole information in the volume. We have information in the three dimensions, the complete subtomograms. However, of course, it takes more time. Depending on what application we want to perform, it's better to use one or the other. For example, if we just want to do a cleaning to remove bad particles, I think it's better to do a cleaning with a two-dimensional classification because it's faster. However, if we want to do a very precise, a very accurate classification, for example, to, I don't know, to differentiate two types of conformation of the same protein or something like that, it will be better to do a three-dimensional classification. Then, after doing the classification, we have the subtomograms, the good subtomograms. So, we are going to do the subtomogram averaging step itself. As I said before, it's two different steps, to create an initial model and then to refine that initial model. So, to create this initial model, we can follow several approaches, different approaches. It will depend if our particles were picked with a non-vectorial picking or with a vectorial picking. I know that you yesterday saw what is a vectorial or directional picking, what is not, but just to remember to you, a non-directional or non-vectorial picking is just a picking where we pick the coordinates of the particles, as we do in single particle. However, at directional picking or vectorial picking is a picking where you pick the coordinate, but also the orientation of the particle with respect to the membrane, for example. So if we have our subtomograms picked with a non-directional or non-vectorial picking, we just have the coordinates. So what we can do is project the volumes, have again bidimensional particles, and with that, we can create initial models using the methods that we use in single particle. For example, some of them that are in XMIP, as you will see in the workflow in the morning. There is also software to perform directly, to do directly an initial model from the three-dimensional subtomograms, for example, using EMAN. However, to do that, you have to do a previous alignment of the subtomograms in order to have or to be able to do this initial model. On the other hand, if we have picked our subtomograms with a directional or vectorial picking, for example, using PiSEC or Dynamo, as you saw yesterday, the thing is that as we have picked the coordinates, the position, but also the orientation, I mean, we have picked the particles and we know that the particles go in that direction, they are more or less perpendicular to the membrane. This information is already an initial alignment because we already have some angles with respect to the membrane. So as the particles already have a kind of alignment, an initial alignment, we can average them directly and with that we construct an initial model as this one. We will do this also in other workflow today. Then, once we have an initial model, what we have to do is to refine that model to have a better resolution map. So there are different programs to refine, but I think the most important ones that we have in Scipion are EMAN and Reliant. So in one workflow, we are going to use EMAN using our ab initio initial model. So we are going to do a refinement of that initial model. And On the other hand, we are going to do another workflow using Reliant. In this case, the particles that we are going to use in Reliant are already have a position because our has been picked directionally. So what we are going to perform is a restricted refinement. That means that these particles already have an initial alignment. We know more or less its orientation. So we are going to allow a little rotation and shift to align them properly, but just little ones, because we know that more or less the correct position is this one. And then one difference between using Iman and using Reliant is how they work with the CTF. In the case of Iman, the program itself estimate the CTF of each of the subtomograms. So we don't have to care about the CTF if we are using Iman. However, if we are using Reliant, we have to provide the initial or the volumes that model the CTF, the three-dimensional CTF of the subtomograms. So we will see how to create these CTF models to pass them to Reliant in order to do the refinement with Reliant. As I told you before, we have another step for the refinement that unfortunately we don't have time today to show it to you, but at least I will tell you briefly more or less what it is, and I will tell you that it's already in Cypen. You can use it if you download the Cypen. So in this case, we have the particle per tilt approach in Iman. We will see in the afternoon that we have something more or less equivalent in Reliant. But for the moment, we are going to see just this approach in Iman. The thing is that this step is a refinement, but taking into account the information in the tilt series. So as I told you before, we are doing subtomogram averaging, but we have to take into account the whole workflow, starting with the tilt series. So how this per particle per tilt refinement in Iman work? Basically, we construct an initial model, as we have said, as we have seen before. Then this initial model is refined with a common refine, the one you can see here, or you will see later in the workflow. And this refinement, what does basically is to divide the subtomograms into subsets and do something similar to the gold standard in single particle. And with this, we got an average map, an average subtomogram, which will be this. As you can see here, you can distinguish some features, more or less resolution. And with this average map and with this alignment that we have computed for all the subtomograms, what we are going to do is to use that alignment of the particles to realign the tilt series. So in this second step, what we are going to do is to take the information of the alignment of the subtomograms. Once we have a good subtomogram average, and use that information to refine the alignment of the tilt series in order to recompute the tomogram. So then we have a more precise alignment in the tilt series, and this allow us to do a more precise reconstruction of the subtomograms and then re-extract the particles in the better aligned tomogram and do again an alignment to obtain a final map that will be this one. So as you can see, this is the map after the per particle per tilt refinement. And as you can see, the resolution has improved. I don't have here the numbers, but you can see mainly in this square that the details in this part of the map are better than the ones in this other map. So as I say, we don't have time to do this today because we don't have time to start from the tilt series, reconstruct the tomogram, and get to the subtomogram averaging step. But this is also integrated in Cypen already. So what are we going to do today with all of this? We are going to basically perform two workflows, ideally one in the morning and one in the afternoon. So in the first one, the one that we will see this morning, we are going to use this dataset, this Empire dataset, with our basically ribosomes, free ribosomes. Okay, that has the tomogram has more or less this this look. And then in the afternoon, we are going to use this other Empire dataset that is from an HIV protein virus of the virus. So as you can see in this tomogram, we have like three ribosomes. So we are going to pick them in a non-directional way, just as we do in single particle. However, as these proteins in the dataset of the afternoon, as this protein, as you can see, are arranged in the capsid of the HIV virus, what we are going to perform here is a directional picking. So in the workflow that we are going to see in the morning, that is the ribosome, we are going to basically import the tomogram directly because we don't have time to reconstruct the tomogram. So we are going to import it. And then we are going to import also an initial volume that is already computed. But when we finish the workflow, if we have time, we are going to see how we have computed this initial volume. Then we are going to perform a non-directional picking, as I said, that is the automatic picking of Iman, which is the template matching. Then we are going to extract that particles. And then we are going to perform the two-dimensional classification by projecting the subtomograms, classifying them with a single particle method for the 2D classification, and then to recover the subtomograms of the particles that are good according to this method. And once we have the good particles, but the good subtomograms, we are going to perform the refinement within. And what we should get should be something like this ribosome. You have to take into account that we are going to work in BEAM4, and thus the resolution that we are going to achieve today is more or less 27 angstroms. However, this is not such a good resolution as the one published in the papers and so on, but this because we are working with BEAM4 and just with one tomogram in order to have time to do this workflow just in this morning. If you perform this workflow, but using all the tomograms and picking more particles and going back to being one, probably you will improve the resolution, but that will take a lot of time and we don't have time to do it today, unfortunately. So that is all about the brief theoretical introduction. So I don't know if you have any doubt because I didn't have time to read the chat. But if you don't have any doubt, I'll pass the controls to Patricia to start with the workflow. Thank you.